Station Flight Control Room at the Johnson Space Center in Houston, and welcome to our continuing coverage throughout the night of the return of the Expedition 41 crew from the International Space Station. At this hour, aboard the Soyuz TMA-13M spacecraft, the three returning crew members who will be landing just a few hours from now on the north-central steppe of Kazakhstan are buttoned up inside their vehicle. Countdown clocks here in the mission control room ticking backward toward the undocking of the Soyuz from the Rosviet module on the Earth-facing side of the International Space Station's Zarya module about 16 and a half minutes from now. On board are Soyuz Commander Max Suraev, who served as the station commander during the Expedition 41 increment, NASA Flight Engineer Reid Wiseman, and European Space Agency Flight Engineer Alexander Gerst. Suraev, as Soyuz commander, is seated in the center seat of the descent module, the centermost module of the three-section Soyuz spacecraft. To his left is the board engineer for this evening's entry and landing back to Earth. That is NASA Flight Engineer Reid Wiseman. Alexander Gerst is seated to Suraev's right. The crew climbed inside the Soyuz spacecraft about 3 hours ago, closed the hatches. You'll be seeing that hatch closure activity in just a moment, and began a series of leak checks to make sure that they had an airtight seal between the Soyuz spacecraft and the Rosviet module before depressurizing the small vestibule or passageway that connects the Soyuz to the Rosviet. The crew then suited up in their Russian Sokol launch and entry suits, conducted leak checks of those suits, and checked out all of the Soyuz systems, which are in excellent shape for the scheduled undocking that is scheduled now at 6:31 p.m. Central Time, 7:31 p.m. Eastern Time.
I did not hear you very well. And if I change the position of the microphone, yes, this is much better, Alexander.
Okay.
We are talking from the second panel, so we'll have to put the microphone close.
You are listening to conversation between the Russian flight control team at the Russian Mission Control Center in Korolyov outside Moscow. You're looking at a live view from a balcony camera overlooking that room as the Russian flight controllers are guiding the three crew members through their procedures in the final steps prior to the undocking itself. That, again, is scheduled less than 15 minutes from now. We mentioned the weather in Kustanai that has apparently resulted in four of the recovery helicopters returning to the airport after they were airborne en route to Arkalik for refueling. The weather in Kustanai appears to be a bit worse than it is actually at the landing site, where the current forecast is calling for scattered clouds at 1,200 feet, a broken ceiling at 2,000 feet, a broken ceiling at 25,000 feet, fairly extensive coverage by the three layers of clouds. The winds are light out of the northeast at about 10 knots. The temperature at landing time expected to be about 23 degrees Fahrenheit. It is just hovering around the 19-degree mark at this moment. The docking mechanism on the Soyuz spacecraft has been powered up per the commands, and we're standing by now for physical separation about 2 minutes from now.
How about now? Is it better? Yes, copy.
The sun docking took place under mutual agreement between the U.S. and Russian sides under the electronically controlled control moment gyroscopes to conserve a propellant on the Russian side, a new technique that has worked to like a charm so far.
Don't be sad. I understand it's not easy to part from the station. Everything is going well here. So don't be sad and your home is waiting for you. Have a picture of the interface as well. That is all clear. Yeah, and we are smoothly separating, observing that the target is moving to the upper right corner.
Soyuz continues its separation activities. A Russian flight controller telling the Soyuz crew, don't be sad, your home awaits you. The first of the two separation burns has been completed, an 8-second firing to initiate that opening rate between the Soyuz and the International Space Station. Soyuz now in a roll maneuver.
The Russian segment is moving upwards. The roll maneuver is complete. Observing. Inaudible. Acceleration will report, yes.
And the second of the two separation burns is now underway. This is a 30-second burn to increase the separation rate between the Soyuz and the International Space Station. Expedition 42 formally underway with the undocking of the Soyuz.
Thrusters burn complete. Confirming via command link.
And now the view of the Soyuz from cameras on the truss of the International Space Station.
P1 is the next one and moving to page 98. Moscow is unintelligible.
Принято, хорошо, не торопится. Хорошо. У нас принято будет, это хорошо.
Тут Москва в цели.
Связи.
Мишка, это Москва?
Мы и один пока не выдаем, правильно? Вот он там прошел. Сам прошел, да, видим. Все, тогда ТВ отключен.
I think TV is off.
There is the Soyuz TMA-13M spacecraft. Soraev, Wiseman, and Gerst on board, having departed their home for the past 5.5 months, currently flying over the Mongolian-Russian border.
Inaudible. D8 commands SVP in work.
Yes, выдали D8
is issued.
An excellent view of the departing Soyuz TMA-13M spacecraft, Max Suraev in the center seat as Soyuz commander, flanked by Reid Wiseman and Alexander Gerst. Their journey of 5.5 months nearing completion, landing scheduled 3 hours, 19 minutes from now.
G4 command is issued, right? Yes. Now, we see this car in work, confirming that. Breaking up. And setting the in for command link, yes. Route then rule in the transportation mode.
И для вашей информации, у нас шарбалонок первый 169 во втором.
169, 167. In the pressure bottles and propellant 497.
У нас следующий сеанс связи начинается
0500 is the next compass. By the next compass, be ready.
On
page 102, and specify the time for GoPro camera.
As the Soyuz departs the neighborhood of the International Space Station, Suraev, Wiseman, and Gerst in the home stretch of their mission that will have spanned 165 days in space, 2,640 orbits of the Earth, 70,008,168 statute miles. Max Suraev wrapping up his second long-duration mission and a total of 334 days in space on those two flights. Of course, Wiseman and Gerst completing their first flight apiece, 165 days in space.
And then we keep working. At 4500, both cameras will be activated. So congratulations with the successful undocking. Yes.
Now looking inside the Harmony module of the International Space Station, you see at the top of the hatchway is a bell. That is a tradition that began more than a decade ago with Expedition 1 Commander Bill Shepard, a Navy captain, ringing the bell upon the departure of vessels coming and going from the International Space Station. And you saw Butch Wilmore, the new commander of the International Space Station for Expedition 42, maintaining the tradition, signifying the departure of the Expedition 41 crew bound for home and a landing. Bound for a landing in the frosty climes of north central Kazakhstan.
Have not had any desets and not anticipating, and so you do have a go to open the USOS shutters.
Outstanding. I'll do that now. Thank you.
You are most welcome, sir.
The deorbit burn is scheduled for 9:05 p.m. Central Time. That deorbit burn scheduled for 4 minutes and 41 seconds, a 128 meter per second braking maneuver, with the firing of the Soyuz engines that will slow its velocity down, allowing it to slip out of orbit to begin its entry back into the Earth's atmosphere. About an hour and 40 minutes from now, sunrise will break over the landing site that is located just 53 miles to the northeast of the remote town of Arkalik, where many Soyuz landings have been staged out of, in this case in part due to logistics and the weather conditions, which are less than optimum but acceptable for this recovery of the Expedition 41 crew. There are 12 Russian Mi-8 helicopters in play, two of which will be dispatched shortly from the Kustanai Airport in Kazakhstan to the ballistic landing zone, which is well to the southwest of the primary landing zone. In the unlikely event a problem with the Soyuz would cause it to land short of its intended target, the nominal plan would call for two other helicopters to fly midway between the prime landing zone and the ballistic landing zone. We'll see if the weather will permit that to take place. And then the eight primary helicopters will be in transit a little over an hour from now, according to the latest report from the field, from Kustanai down to the prime landing zone. They will arrive at the landing zone and fly in a racetrack oval-shaped pattern, awaiting the arrival of the Soyuz under its main parachute. We will see how the weather unfolds over the course of the next few hours in determining how the Russian search and recovery forces, which are called Rosaviatsa, it's a Russian civilian aviation and air authority recovery branch of the Russian federal government. Rosaviatsa, very skilled, very expert at recovering Soyuz crews under all types of weather circumstances. It remains to be seen whether or not they will take the time to erect an inflatable medical tent, that is the nominal procedure, or whether the weather conditions would cause them to essentially load the crew back into respective helicopters for the flight back to Kustanai in a time-saving maneuver to a distance of about 12 kilometers for the deorbit burn at 9.05 p.m. Central Time that will send the crew into an entry back into the Earth's atmosphere and a landing to the northeast of the town of Arkalik, Kazakhstan, with landing scheduled at 9.58 p.m. Central Time, 9.58 a.m. in Kazakhstan on Monday morning. All of the Soyuz systems are operating normally as we prepare to end our undocking coverage and set the stage to come back on the air in about an hour and 45 minutes at 8.45 p.m. Central Time, 9.45 p.m. Eastern Time with our deorbit and landing coverage to bring the Expedition 41 crew home after 165 days in space. So we'll wrap it up for now. We'll be back in an hour and 45 minutes. Enjoy your evening. This is Mission Control Houston.
So, you know, our commander is, you know, flying from us, so... Okay, so you are not asleep, right? So how is it, Sasha, with you? We're okay, thank you. We were sleepy a little bit, but you know... Okay, could you please pass my regards to Lena and talk to you later, guys? Lena hears your words. Thank you so much. Okay, good luck to you. Cetius, Moscow. Go ahead, Moscow.
Максим, на формате топлива.
Максим,
the
propellant format pressure should be 752 settings. Okay, 752. Is it correct? Yes, that's right, Максим. Okay, it's been input 752. We have three axis orientation, and we confirm that we have joined GSR, and it's 180, 180, and 0. Status, Moscow, you can perform step 6 on the BNO format, monitor the settings, okay, copy, Moscow. Zero 07, do we have it? Yes. Crew members talking to each other. I think everything is nominal, Maxim. Yes, I think so too. Yes, and the first stage is 7 to 8. I think it's all fine.
Первый, get a beam.
128.0. That's great. And the quaternion is 1000 6060507. Everything is nominal. Celsius, Moscow, 0545 will be the equivalent inhibit. So 20 minutes will be until SKD thrusters activation, and it will be page 105. Okay, copy that, Moscow.
So Moscow, we will get the
Good evening from the International Space Station Flight Control Room at the Johnson Space Center in Houston, and welcome to our coverage of the return home of the Expedition 41 crew after 165 days in space. At this hour, everything is in readiness for the engine firing on the Soyuz TMA-13M spacecraft that undocked from the station at 6:31 p.m. Central Time this evening. That deorbit burn, a 4-minute, 41-second retrograde firing of the Soyuz engine to slow down the Soyuz's velocity and allow it to drop out of orbit, is just 19 and a half minutes away. Crew of Wiseman, Soyuz, and Gerst an opportunity to say goodbye one final time with their farewells and hatch closure beginning at 3:20 p.m. Central Time about 5.5 hours ago. Let's take a look at that hatch closure video right now.
Наш командир!
Ну что, поехали домой?
Домой, домой.
Поехали домой? Ready to go home?
Let's go.
Let's go.
Ты первый.
Let's go.
And with Elena Sorova watching over the crew, they had an opportunity for final farewells with one another before the three Expedition 41 crew members entered their Soyuz TMA-13M spacecraft that docked to the station initially on May 29th, following their launch from the Baikonur Cosmodrome in Kazakhstan. That vehicle attached to the Rosviet module on the Earth-facing side of the Russian segment of the International Space Station was powered up on autonomous power shortly after the crew got inside. The crew then donned their Russian Sokol launch and entry suits, conducted leak checks at the time that they closed the hatches that you'll see here just a moment from now.
Maxim,
and there went the hatch closing on the Soyuz side at 3:27 p.m. Central Time. That was followed just a few minutes later as Alexander Samokutyayev, that you see there in the Rosviet module, closed the hatch on the station side of the docking interface. With everything in order, the hooks were opened and springs on both sides of the docking interface pushed off against one another at 6:31 p.m., enabling the Soyuz vehicle to undock over northern China near the Mongolian border right on time. Two separate engine firings of the Soyuz engine and separation burns enabled an opening rate between the Soyuz and the International Space Station, allowing the Soyuz to drift to a point where it is now some 12 kilometers away from the station with everything in readiness for the deorbit burn. The weather is not ideal, but it is acceptable. The current forecast calling for scattered clouds at 1,200 feet, a broken ceiling at 2,000 feet, and a broken ceiling at 25,000 feet. The current temperature at the landing site is hovering around 21 degrees Fahrenheit. The reports from the recovery team, the Rosaviatsa search and recovery forces, and the teams of NASA and European Space Agency support personnel indicate that all of the helicopters are now airborne from Kustanai, Kazakhstan, en route to the landing site. They were delayed in taking off earlier in the day because of low clouds and unacceptable conditions for flying those helos. And the report now from one of the helicopters en route to the landing site indicates that the helos, which left the Kustanai Airport in five minute intervals to provide the appropriate separation distance in this less than desirable visibility, that those helicopters are flying very low and below the clouds, and that it is unlikely that we would see the Soyuz descending under its main parachute, much as we have enjoyed for the past two landings in May and September. But we shall see what the weather holds for us over the course of the next hour and 5 minutes. Time will tell whether or not the decision is made to erect an inflatable medical tent, as is customary for Soyuz landings, or whether or not the weather conditions would prompt a quicker recovery operation for the crew today, enabling the search and recovery forces to simply extract the crew and then load them on helicopters for the flight back to Kustanai, where a NASA jet is waiting to carry Reid Wiseman and Alexander Gerst first out of Kazakhstan on a flight to Scotland, where Gerst will disembark and be met by European Space Agency personnel for a flight back to the European Astronaut Center, Wiseman continuing on to arrive in Houston, and Max Suraev to board a Gagarin Cosmonaut Training Center aircraft to fly back to his training base in Star City, just outside of Moscow. A 4 minute, 41 second braking maneuver by the Soyuz engine to slow it down and allow it to drop out of orbit. Some 27 minutes after the deorbit burn, the pyrotechnics will take place to separate the three sections of the Soyuz. The descent module has the crew inside, and as they enter the Earth's atmosphere, they'll be experiencing temperatures about 2,500 degrees Fahrenheit that will be repelled around the Soyuz by its heat shield. In sequential fashion, the command to open up a pilot parachute, a drogue chute, and a main parachute will take place. The crew will descend under its main chute with its altimeter providing its computers information on its altitude and rate of descent, and then just a few seconds before touchdown, the soft landing engines at the base of the Soyuz will fire in one final braking maneuver, and the crew will be back on Earth. Once the deorbit burn is complete, the upper compartment, the orbital module, which is the top section of the three-section Soyuz vehicle, will be depressurized to set the stage for the module separation that will occur later in the ride home for the crew. We once again will mention that once the Soyuz passes at a range of about 124 miles or 200 kilometers away from the International Space Station, that is the limit of any guaranteed space-to-space VHF voice communication from the Soyuz. As has happened in the past, the communications could become choppy, and we could lose communication altogether with the crew as they descend through the Earth's atmosphere. That communication would not become usable again, and certainly not consistent until they pass within range of the Antonov 12, the fixed-wing aircraft at the landing site that is currently flying over the landing site to serve as a communications relay station, if you will.
You must be ready for this thruster activation, right? Yes, we are ready, Moscow. 7 minutes for one mark, and please monitor how the commands go through.
Yeah.
Will do, Moscow.
At this hour, the International Space Station and the Soyuz vehicle flying 12 kilometers apart, passing 262 statute miles just to the east of Argentina, about to begin a southwest to northeasterly track across the South Atlantic in an orbit inclined 51.6 degrees to either side of the equator. Now just over 2 minutes from the deorbit burn.
Don't be sad.
1 minute away from the deorbit burn.
Another flight after the... Okay, the command on the mode stabilization went through and as the... Yes, we are waiting for the opening of the SCD cover. The cover is open. Do you confirm? Do you confirm, Maxim, there is GSO or in attitude signal? Yes. And we are standing by for Maxim. It's a reminder. During the descent, please do the reports.
Now just 15 seconds away, standing by for the initiation of the deorbit burn.
Come with us. Okay, copy, Moscow. The thruster activated.
And the deorbit burn is now underway.
047 is acceleration.
Over the South Atlantic, a 4 minute, 41 second retrograde firing of the Soyuz engine.
7 meters, 8 meters, the thruster. Operated for 25 seconds, 046 is acceleration. It's page 107. Okay, this thruster worked for 38 seconds, propellant 32 seconds, 045 is the acceleration. Okay, so the burn and the time of operation, 58 seconds, 26.7, 1 minute, 28.
Max Suraev reporting back to the Russian flight control team on the duration of the burn, the rate of deceleration and propellant consumption.
3, 48, 49, 106 meters. And the pressure is stable. 047 is the acceleration. 3 minutes, 59. 4 minutes. 256 kilograms propellant.
About 40 seconds left in the deorbit burn.
Minutes, 10 seconds. 115 meters. 4 minutes. 20 seconds. 120 meters. 4 minutes, 27, 28 seconds, 125 meters. Okay, the command is sent, GK. So the burn is complete, 128 meters, 128.1. The thruster, the activated. The cut-off command went through.
And the deorbit burn is complete and perfect. Expedition 41 on its way home after 165 days in space. A Russian Air Force Colonel, Max Suraev, an American Navy commander and test pilot, Reid Wiseman, and a German volcanologist, Alexander Gerst, heading home for a frozen scrub of land on the steppe of Kazakhstan. Touchdown expected less than 48 minutes from now.
And clear, and we copy your report. Thank you. 320 bo pressure, SA 789 and stable. Copy.
The next major milestone will be the separation, the pyrotechnic separation of the three sections of the Soyuz vehicle. In advance of that, the uppermost section, known as the orbital module, has been depressurized. The crew is monitoring all of that activity on board. About 12 or so minutes from now, the Soyuz will be passing out of the guaranteed range of communications for space-to-space VHF voice capability through the antennas on the International Space Station. But we'll continue to monitor all of the conversation on this VHF loop. The Soyuz crew eventually will come into range of an Antonov 12 fixed-wing aircraft that is a flying command and control center for the Russian search and recovery forces. All of the helicopters have departed the Kustanai airport. They're en route, flying low below thick decks of clouds, en route to the landing site some 53 miles to the northeast of the town of Arkalik.
Было. Pressure 36 millimeters. ESA or descent module is 789 and stable. Copy, Cepheus, we copy you loud and clear. Same here, Moscow. Maxim, it's a reminder. Before the arming of the seats, please monitor that there are no foreign objects that might be in the way of the seats. Gosha, I understand. When possible, we will do it every minute that there are no foreign objects that might interfere with the arming of the seats. Thank you so much, Maxim. I'm very grateful. You're welcome.
And, of course, the Soyuz vehicle flying at a lower altitude now as it prepares to enter the Earth's atmosphere, traveling over Western Africa, moving from southwest to northeast.
This is Moscow. Cepheus, Moscow, if you can hear us, please.
Gosha,
the separation is at 6:32, right? It's Alex from ISS. Yes, 32:47. Okay, 47. 5 minutes. Cepheus, Moscow, if you can hear, please reply.
And again, this was expected, loss of communications because of the distance between the International Space Station flying at an altitude of 262 statute miles.
How copy? Gosha, it's very quiet. There was some noise, and that's it. Copy, Alex.
We are about 4 minutes away from the expected separation of the three sections of the Soyuz vehicle. That will occur at an altitude of 87 miles above the Earth. We are currently just under 30 minutes until touchdown.
Cepheus, Moscow, if you can hear us. This is Moscow. This is Mission Control Moscow. How do you read us? That is ISS. This is Mission Control Moscow. ISS calling Soyuz, ISS calling Soyuz.
Station Moscow on Space to Ground 1 for Елена. Елена? What is the date? What are the numbers? So the purity error is about 40.
Mission Control Moscow. There is no noise whatsoever. We heard some clicking initially, now it is really quiet. I understand, Sasha. If you start hearing them, let us know right away. Absolutely.
If everything is proceeding as planned, the modules should be separating from one another, the pyrotechnic separation between the three sections. And data received at the Russian Mission Control Center indicates that the three sections have in fact separated.
The information that the separation occurred.
The visiting vehicle officer here in Mission Control confirms through data received that the module separation has occurred. So the descent module is now flying free.
That's good. Thank God.
As it prepares to enter the Earth's atmosphere with temperatures around the spacecraft building to some 2,500 degrees.
Must have. That is obvious, yes. Believe me. Sofia, Mission Control Moscow. This is, yeah, do you hear us? Yes. First, we hear you now.
And although the communications is sporadic, the Soyuz crew in good shape, acknowledging the calls of flight controllers at the Russian Mission Control Center.
This is Mission Control Center calling Moscow. Do you hear us? No, this is,
24 minutes until touchdown. The Russian search and recovery forces and the Mi-8 helicopters en route to the landing site.
Moscow, if you hear us, please report on separation.
The flight control team in Korolyov asking the crew on board the Soyuz, if they can hear the calls up to them to confirm the module separation. However, data received on the ground through the Antonov 12 fixed-wing aircraft indicates that we did have a nominal module separation standing by for the Soyuz to now enter the Earth's atmosphere at an altitude of 400,000 feet.
If you hear us, please report on separation.
This is Mission Control Houston, receiving our first views from the landing site to the northeast of Arkalik. The visibility is not terrible. There are low clouds, several decks of low clouds that likely will preclude our ability to see the Soyuz descending under the parachute. The temperature is quite cold, in the low 20s Fahrenheit, but otherwise the landing conditions are said to be favorable by those in charge of the search and recovery operations on scene. Under 20 minutes now until touchdown. The crew now experiencing maximum G loads of about 3 to 4 G's. This should last only a few minutes as we are standing by now for the command that will open the parachutes. That's expected about 2 minutes from now.
Снимаем вас с цепей. Слышим?
Да, перегрузка. 5. Начала падать. Максимально было 5 единиц.
Принято 5 единиц. Без спуска доложите.
Okay, so the G-loads were 5 and... 7 seconds. So far, everything is nominal, Moscow. Copy, Cephas. 0, 13, 15.
Перегрузка.
Roll. 3.5 is G-load. It is dropping. Okay, copy, Cephas.
Перегрузочка. 3 единички.
3 now is G-load. We are approaching the completion of the control. Okay, copy. G-load. And the G-load is, please continue reporting. We copy you now.
Good news. Communications established with the Russian Mission Control Center and the crew on board the Soyuz descent module. Everything in great shape. The crew reporting it feels well. And you can hear from time to time the beeping of the Soyuz radio beacon that is sending out navigational information to the Antonov fixed-wing aircraft, the command and control aircraft that is flying over the landing zone. Next up will be the command to begin the deployment of the parachutes. First, two pilot parachutes are deployed, the second of which extracts the drogue chute. The drogue chute is then released, measuring about 24 square meters, slowing the Soyuz down from a descent rate of 230 meters per second to just 80 meters per second. That will be followed in short order by the release of the main parachute that covers an area of about 1,000 meters. The release of the main chute slows the Soyuz to a descent rate of about 7 meters per second, first yanking the Soyuz to an angle of about 30 degrees to expel heat, then shifting the Soyuz to a straight vertical descent.
Oh.
Сигнал Jettison.
And reports being received at the Russian Mission Control Center indicate that the crew is reporting it's feeling well. Those communications being relayed directly to the Antonov 12 fixed-wing aircraft at the landing site.
Calm with the search and rescue, and everything is going nominally. Okay, good, good, good things, God. And just let us know what we are doing with the config here. And yeah, you can just go ahead and switch the calm. There is no... We don't need combined loops anymore, so please just go back to the nominal COM configuration. And that's, okay, good, good. We'll start that.
And we're about 6.5 minutes away from touchdown. Everything continuing to proceed by the book as the Soyuz descends under its main parachute toward landing. In a barren section of north-central Kazakhstan where the temperature is now calculated at 23 degrees Fahrenheit to greet the returning Expedition 41 crew. The heat shield having been discarded, the altimeter at the base of the Soyuz descent module is calculating the current altitude toward the landing site and the rate of descent, and we'll feed that information into the onboard computers to trigger the firing of the soft landing engines just a few seconds before touchdown. This is Mission Control Houston. The front screen of the Russian Mission Control Center with the Russian words Yest Posadka flashing as it always does, indicating they've landed. We are still waiting for a further confirmation, but it appears as if the crew landed just shy of 9:59 p.m. Central Time, which would be 9:59 a.m. in Kazakhstan on Monday morning, again awaiting confirmation from the Russian search and recovery forces.
The vehicle landed, lying on the site, and
we now have word from the Russian search and recovery forces that the vehicle landed on its side.
Search and rescue team.
So that is a data point for the first wave of helicopters that will be landing to help extract the crew. Again, landing occurring virtually on the dot at 9:58 and 35 seconds p.m. Central Time, tipping over onto its side. Not uncommon for that to happen. So we'll be standing by for further reports and any video that we may be getting shortly from the landing site itself. We're going to be getting some replays here, it appears, of the Soyuz in the final seconds of its descent for landing that we're looking at the moment. And here's our replay of landing. Let's keep you on the line here for just a second. And there were the soft landing engines firing just a second before touchdown. That occurred at 9:58 p.m. Central Time, not quite an hour ago. The crew was extracted within about 35 minutes. And there's a sight we don't typically see, the wind carrying the parachute. And tipping the Soyuz over onto its side, but you can see how quickly the initial team of search and recovery personnel were at the scene to attend to the crew and its their rapid extraction from the descent module. That is the only section of the three-section Soyuz spacecraft that is brought home. This is Mission Control Houston. The initial helicopters on the ground, part of the Russian search and recovery forces, as we stand by for the transmission of video from the landing site. Everything proceeding in smooth order with the crew. And there's our first view of Soyuz Commander Max Suraev, who served as the Expedition 41 commander as well, having wrapped up his second flight into space and an aggregate total of 334 days in space on his two missions. As always, quite upbeat, flashing the V for victory sign, being attended by the first Russian medical personnel who were on the first helicopter down at the landing site. You can see patches of snow. A multinational crew returning home today, wrapping up their 5.5 month mission. Suraev conducted one spacewalk during his time on orbit, a 3-hour, 38-minute excursion with Alexander Samokutyayev that occurred late in the increment. That followed two U.S. spacewalks out of the Quest airlock in U.S. Extravehicular mobility units. Reid Wiseman conducting two spacewalks, the first with Alexander Gerst, the second with Barry Wilmore, who now is on board the station, along with Elena Sorova and Alexander Samokutyayev, as a three-person crew for the next 2 weeks until they are joined by the next trio of residents, who will be launched 2 weeks from today, U.S. time, in the wee hours of Monday, November 24th, that consisting of NASA flight engineer Terry Virts, who will become the commander of Expedition 43 next March. He'll be launched along with Soyuz commander Anton Shkaplerov and another European Space Agency flight engineer, Samantha Cristoforetti.
Просто у меня здесь генератор просто очень забивать его.
А это машину может.
This all part of the routine initial medical tests that are performed by the Russian nurses and flight surgeons following a landing of a Soyuz vehicle. There are teams of NASA and European Space Agency personnel that are part of this recovery team, and they'll be attending to Reid Wiseman and Alexander Gerst here shortly after they're extracted from the Soyuz. And Alexander Gerst of the European Space Agency. A German volcanologist who spent 5.5 months on board the International Space Station looking none the worse for wear.
Продует. I have one right here. What about yours?
This is a very, very important time for the European Space Agency. Gerst returning to Earth this evening. This is followed on Tuesday by the anticipated landing of the Philae lander from the Rosetta spacecraft on the comet that the mothership has been orbiting now for some time. And in 2 weeks, the launch of Samantha Cristoforetti, the Italian Air Force pilot who will be launched to the International Space Station for a 5.5-month mission of her own.
Олег Николаевич, я плохо вас слышу, но да, докладываю вам. Да, все хорошо, все хорошо.
Олег Николаевич, I cannot hear very well, but I'm reporting everything is good.
Я вам пытался дозвониться.
Understood. I tried calling you today all day and yesterday, but failed to reach you. I mean, yesterday, actually. I cannot hear you. All right. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thanks. Thank you. Bye.
Мы ее привезли, видимо, на 15-м борту. Я что-то не развернулся.
A Soyuz landing day for the returning crew members is as much an endurance test as it is a test of technical prowess, an extremely long day. This began early Sunday morning when the crew woke up. They had a final meal together with the remaining crew members on board, Barry Wilmore, Alexander Samokutyaev, and Elena Sorova.
Doesn't hurt anywhere.
Before they moved into final farewells and hatch closure, shortly after 3 p.m. Central Time, the preparations for undocking that occurred at 6:31 p.m. Central Time, and then the deorbit burn and the high-speed entry back into the Earth's atmosphere. And there is Reid Wiseman, the NASA flight engineer, home after 5.5 months in space.
That's what you call adrenaline, it's going to force some more veins.
Naval commander and test pilot Reid Wiseman, who became a worldwide sensation through social media during his time up on orbit, back seated next to his crewmates Max Suraev and Alexander Gerst. On the right is his flight surgeon, Dr. Steve Hart.
So you've got water? Yes. Are you thirsty? A little bit.
Yeah,
that's all right. I can drink later. So what's the pressure for MCC? Hey, dude. parachute, and even we were just about to land directly, but because of the parachute, we ended on one side. But other than that, everything is nominal. Would you like to say something to your family? Yes, here I am, here we are, on Earth, we'll soon be back home. But in fact, if I can elaborate a little bit, I can say that we've been left without some details on board the station, but we are hearing what's going on now, and here is a perfect example. Here have Germany and the US. They have worked together for half a year. We've completed our fine program. We've received a few cargo vehicles and space vehicles. Everything was fine. Everything was in the spirit of cooperation. So I think that everybody needs to learn and follow the example of ISS crew members. Don't get insulted. Don't try to prove anything to each other. Let's try and live together side by side. This is the most important thing, and then we'll have good results. Yeah, showing a good example. Thank you.
Max Suraev providing his own commentary and assessment of his own expedition and a lesson in international cooperation, touting the cooperation that he and his crewmates, who had a special affection for one another and an affinity for spaceflight, a Russian Air Force colonel, Reid Wiseman there, a Navy commander test pilot, and a German scientist, a volcanologist, Alexander Gerst, now home back on Earth after 165 days in space.
Please hold it like this.
Yeah, we do, absolutely. I can wait.
What was the question? Can
we do that?
We've
just landed. The best commander, Maxim Viktorovich, excellent commander, and I'm certainly very happy to be back on Earth. This is very good. And it's nice, it'd be nice if it snowed. Because the air is cold right now. Thank you very much.
Wiseman hailing the exploits of his Soyuz commander, Max Suraev, and perhaps a few words forthcoming from Alexander Gerst now.
Yes, I can.
I
need to ask the doctor. He has not landed just yet. That's fine, let's go ahead. So, number three, please. So, are you ready? Alexander, good morning. Good morning. Congratulations on the successful landing. Thank you. Would you mind saying a few words about how the landing went? Went well? Nominal for us, for me. My first time in space. First time I got back from space. And it was good. I felt myself fine. Good. Great team with our leader, Max. Thank you for your support, of course. To everybody. Thank you and all the best. Thanks. Could you wave your hand for the mission control?
I'm not bad. Everything is amazingly heavy in my head, a little busy, but overall not bad.
Я вообще не знаю, что.
So comments from all three crew members, prompted by a member of the search and recovery forces, Alexei Lukianov, who asked all three crew members for their reaction to their on-time landing that went by the book as the Soyuz TMA-13M spacecraft touched down about 53 miles to the northeast of the town of Arkaluk. The crew will be
time to move.
Returning to the staging city of Kustanai, Kazakhstan, before long for further medical exams, and there they will split up, with Wiseman and Gerst boarding a NASA jet flying back to Scotland, where Gerst will be dropped off to be greeted by other European Space Agency personnel that will be followed by Wiseman pressing ahead to fly back to Houston. Soyuz will be flying back to Star City, Russia, and his training base.
Hello, we're from Chelyabinsk, your hometown. We've just come here for the purpose of seeing you, talking to you. Can you say something to your fellow countrymen? Well, what can I say? I'm really happy. I'm glad that the dreams have been fulfilled. That's the most important thing, that even the most reckless adventures do.
A broad smile on the face of Reid Wiseman, who returned home today along with Max Suraev and Alexander Gerst 5.5 months after leaving the planet. Wiseman conducted 2 spacewalks during his time on orbit. Record amount of research conducted by this crew along with their other crewmates on board the International Space Station.
All right, I gotta go. Love you guys. And I'll talk to you soon.
Other helicopters are in the process of landing. One of them containing NASA Public Affairs Officer Dan Hewitt, who has been part of the NASA recovery team. We may be hearing from him shortly. Soyuz now being hoisted in his reclining chair to be brought into the nearby inflatable medical tent, where it has been determined that there will be time for other post-landing medical exams. The crew will have an opportunity now to get out of their Russian Sokol launch and entry suits into more comfortable clothing before they are brought back into respective helicopters to be flown back to Kustanai, Kazakhstan, the staging city for today's landing operations. In 23-degree weather, with patches of snow on the ground, you can see that the Soyuz was moved into an upright position, enabling RSC Energia personnel to begin removing some of the critical cargo that was brought back to Earth in the descent module. The crew is now back inside the medical tent. They'll be assisted out of their Sokol launch and entry suits. This will take the better part of about 45 minutes to an hour before they are loaded back onto Russian Mi-8 helicopters, 3 of them, to be flown about 2 hours back to the staging city of Kustanai, Kazakhstan. You're looking at the inflatable medical tent, which is just several yards away from the Soyuz descent module. Joel, inside the medical tent, the three crew members who have returned home from space aboard the Soyuz TMA-13M spacecraft, and at the landing site is NASA Public Affairs Officer Dan Hewitt. Dan, greetings to you on what appears to be a frosty Monday morning in Kazakhstan. How are things at the landing site?
Well, hey, Rob, as you can see, it's already beginning to look not so much here where I'm standing, but there's been quite a bit of snow in the country. We hit a bit of weather, as you probably heard about, on our way out here. The helos got a little delayed, and I myself actually just stepped down as they were carrying the crew in. But if anything, it's just another testament to the robustness of the Soyuz and the capabilities of all these search and recovery forces to get us out here safely today.
Dan, so if you can, give us a glimpse now of the chronology of what the crew will be doing over the next few hours, the return trip, and how they will be dispositioned from this point on.
Yeah, sure thing. So right now they're in the medical tent. They're doing their initial checkouts. Reid Wiseman is going to be participating in, he's going to be the latest participant in a series of field test exercises that we've been doing with some of the crew members as soon as they get down on the ground. Those exercises looking at very basic things, you know, having the astronaut stand up, basic functions, things like that, that may not sound like much, but when you're readapting to gravity after 6 months, you know, the first couple of hours can be very vital, not only for these returning astronauts. That's going to be a very important data point for us if we send astronauts will be able to function as soon as they hit gravity again once they get back down on the ground. So once we're done here in the medical tent, as you can see, we're moving pretty quickly, trying to get everybody out of the cold. We're going to load them into the choppers and head back on up to Kusanai, where we'll do the welcoming ceremony, depending on how the guys are feeling. And then they'll be heading back to home bases, Max Drive, getting in the GCTC plane, heading back to Star City in Russia. And then Reid Wiseman and Alexander Gerst are going to get on the NASA plane and make their way back over to Houston. Alexander Gerst will actually be going straight back to his home base in Europe, though.
And Dan, looking at the cold weather that you're enduring at this moment makes my bones chill, since we'll be launching another trio of crew members in 2 weeks, and it only gets colder from here. This is a live view now from the landing site. The Soyuz was placed back into an upright position. The stand with its ladder built around the Soyuz to enable technical personnel to begin extracting cargo from inside the Soyuz descent module. Up on the International Space Station, three crew members continue the uninterrupted continuous human presence that began with the arrival of the Expedition 1 crew back on November 2nd, 2000. Now more than 14 years of a continuous U.S. presence aboard the station, being maintained by the new Expedition 42 commander, Barry Wilmore of NASA, and his Russian crewmates, Alexander Samokutyayev and Elena Sorova of the Russian Federal Space Agency. Together, they will form a three-person crew for the next 2 weeks until the next trio of residents will be launched from the Baikonur Cosmodrome, which is well to the southwest of this landing site. That trio consisting of NASA flight engineer Terry Virts, Soyuz commander Anton Shkaplerov, and European Space Agency flight engineer Samantha Cristoforetti. Last week, they wrapped up all of their training preparations at the Gagarin Cosmonaut Training Center in Star City outside of Moscow, and will be flying down to the launch site of the Baikonur Cosmodrome on Tuesday, on Veterans Day, to begin their final 2 weeks of pre-launch training. Their launch is scheduled on Sunday, November 23rd, U.S. time, at 3:01 p.m. Central Time, which will be 3:01 a.m. at the Baikonur Cosmodrome on Monday, November 24th, launching on a four-orbit, six-hour rendezvous to reach the International Space Station.